So I will be talking something about Kafka in relation to Rust, and maybe get you also to pick up Rust sometime. Who has heard of Rust before? Also. So it's called a system language, but it has all kinds of nice libraries that make it also pretty easy to set up applications. It's still not as easy as for Java, but it's kind of getting there. So first something about me. It's like my Twitter and stuff. Like yours said, I'm working at Open Web, mostly Java development. I used Kafka several times. So for example, in the police, there was a project. And then we used Kafka to basically for all the page views that users of a CMS were getting, and then putting them to Kafka so they could see them in Kibana and do analysis on them. I'm also the author of the Schema Registry Converter. That's like the Rust library to use the Confluent Schema Registry, because that was something that was still missing, and I wanted to write some stuff in Rust, and I kind of had to write that to make it work. And I'm living in Papendrecht, and there's some books and interests and some cats. I also like to run sometimes if I'm not developing. So the contents of the talk, I will first tell something about the test setup. That's kind of a thing that has been developing like 1.5 years in my spare time. It's a setup of different kind of microservices around Kafka. Then I will tell something about the three different languages that I use to implement stuff in, some results of the tests I run, and then some conclusions. And then there's room for questions. You can also ask questions in the meantime, as long as it's not diverting too much. So something I made is like a little bank simulation where you can kind of create an account, and then an IBAN gets created, and then you can kind of add money to it, subscribe money. And there's also like the view for a bank employee where you can view every account. And it's working with GraphQL. So you're making a subscription to see all the transactions happening. So this is kind of the whole setup. So there's like the orange parts are the parts from the Kafka and the Confluent Schema Registry. So the Schema Registry is used for the data to set it up. There's several benefits. One of them is like the messages can be very small because it's just numbers and strings. And then if it was JSON, then the messages would be a lot bigger, because then all the keys also had to be in the same message. And how, of course, when you then read the message, you need to know which was the schema used with the message. And the way the Confluent Schema Registry does this is there's a number encoded in it, and that's used. You can fetch that to JSON. So that's also that, like the Schema Registry Converter does, is picking out that number from the binary, getting the JSON from the Schema Registry, and then transforms it into something that Rust can work with. The yellow parts are kind of microservices that I will go to in some detail next. So this is like the shared library. This stuff is, all the yellow ones are just the initial ones I built in Clojure. So this is some shared stuff so that all the applications know which topics there are, knows the schemas, and most importantly also have the compiled Avro objects to talk to Kafka. And there's also some logging and stuff, and also some utility methods for the producer and the consumers, because there are now like 3 or 4 clients for Clojure. Also, most of them have like the consumer and the producer, but there are even some that have also support for streams, and one even also supports Avro without having to add any dependencies, because the dependency for the Confluent Avro is already in there. So this is like a small app to make it very easy for me to set things up and tear things down, because I used the Confluent CLI, and then you can just type Confluent start Schema registry, and then locally you just get your zookeeper, Kafka, and Schema registry. And then with the synchronizer, I can just create the topics I need and also put in the schemas I need into the Schema registry and just do something and then just afterwards tear down again. And then the Heartbeat application, that's not too confused with the Kafka Heartbeat. That's just sending very small messages with basically just a long of a counter at the given time. And with that, I can produce load, which I in order to test the performance of the system. So then the command generator, that's like reading the messages from the heartbeat. So when it's the heartbeat does nothing, it also doesn't do anything. And then for each message it receives, it will generate a command. And it's like there are only two commands in the system. There's one to generate an account and one to try to transfer money. And both could fail. So there's also for both of them, there's like a succeed message and a failed message. And they're all on separate topics. Then there's the command handler that is like the core of the application. And that's also the part that I've also written in Kotlin and also two implementations in Rust. So it's either getting a command to generate an account, and then it tries to generate an IBAN checks in the database if the IBAN exists already or not. And then when it's not already existing, it transfers back the generated IBAN together with a token. And it can also be used to transfer money, and then checking the database. If it will not go below the limit, that's also set in the database. And if that's fine, it will transfer the money and also generate a balance change event. This is about the GraphQL endpoint. That's kind of the most complicated part. And it's offering different subscriptions to the front end to handle the data and also to trigger produce events. So for example, you can, I can go to detail in the next one. So that's like the transaction server. And that's really to keep track of all the changes in balances. And you can also make a subscription. So for example, you can say to the transaction service, give me all the transactions that are above 500 euros or something like that. And then when it's reading it from Kafka via WebSocket, it will push it to the client. Then there's the account creation servers. So that's, well, a bit simpler. That's just creating the accounts, storing it into the database. Together with the hash of the password, so it can be checked when someone logs in again that it's getting the same account. And then the money transfer servers, that's like checking if the, because if you want to transfer money, you also supply a token, so it checks if the token is fine, but that's like happening in the back. Because this is just sending out the message to transfer the money and then gets back whether it succeeds or fails. And when it fails, it also shows up at the front end. But that's like in the front end part, so that's like all the stuff used, because it's using Clojure script. And then with the library, that's Reframe, and that's packing React. So you get, you have like all your states is in one place in with Reframe, and then based on the state, the view is generated, which makes it really easy to do stuff. And Reframe, and I also use the library Regraph. That's really a tiny thing that's making Reframe easy to work with GraphQL. And then it's really easy to make subscriptions and do queries on them. And it's all served by Nginx, so it's just a static container. So now I also have the thing to run the test. It's also set up to work on Travis CI. And then, well, everything is in Docker, is running in Docker except for running the actual test. So it's using a thing from Spotify to connect to Docker to actually get the CPU and the memory from the Docker containers. And it's also, as it's running the test, it's using the connection with the heartbeat to increase the load till it comes at a certain point that I run the test now that if it's failed to give feedback 5 seconds three times, then the test stops. So it's also measuring, it's like trying to make a transaction and then measuring the time from making the transaction on the screen till it gets its feedback by the GraphQL connection again. And then I also made a thing to analyze the data from the run tests and put them into an HTML file, which can then be served by the Nginx again. So who knows about Clojure? So mentioned it a couple of times, but like Rich Hickley is the benevolent dictator for life of Clojure, so it's kind of like what he wants with the language that happens. Which is nice in some ways, because there's like really a view of what the language should be, and that makes it very nice to use. It's a dynamic language, but it also has parts, ways to make it more typed. So there's like a library that's called spec, and then you can say, I expect this data to be a map, and there's this and this and this keys in, and if there's this key in, then the data should be, for example, like a string, and it should not be more than, not be longer than 10 characters or something like that. And the company behind it is Cognitect. That's not like one of the great names. And the product they have is Datomic, which is a database kind of thing that's very close to your code. But it's all, yeah, it's in Clojure, and it's very nice to use with Clojure, but it's sometimes also used with Java, but that's kind of harder. This some code example. That's just something I've got to mention. It's a Lisp, so it's a lot of brackets everywhere. But yeah, if you really count it, then like Java or Kotlin also has a lot of them, and also Rust. And so there is the Java interop. So you things like this is just a kind of weird syntax to work with Java. So anything that's in Java, you can also use in Clojure. So that's nice. And there's also a lot of libraries out there that are just like wrapping a Java library and making it more fit to the Clojure paradigm and more functional. What's also nice is you can just, it's functions are first citizen, so you can just pass functions along to another function to start something. Then something about Kotlin. Who knows about Kotlin? Who's written Kotlin? Or yeah. So it's, I still see this kind of like a bit better Java, because like there's the default to immutability, which is nice, but well, you can still have mutable stuff also very easily in Kotlin. This is like very tied to IntelliJ's editor, which also makes it very nice to just, you can just paste in Java code and then makes Kotlin code of it. And what's also nice is you can really quite easily just run Kotlin and Java code together, which in Clojure is a bit more hard to do. And of course, it got a lot of support both by Spring and by Google. Because also like on Spring Starter, you can just very easily start a Spring Kotlin project, and then all the setup is done for you. It can be a pain to get the configuration right, especially when you use the Confluent Streamer registry, because you have to put in some details like the use native encoding and also the serializer set correctly, but then it works. And then you can create code like this, that you have really like a mapping from your input to your output, and also have like your topics in your YAML file, because it's really, and then it's really easy to switch out topics. And because of how Spring works, it's also very easy to, if you work with Docker, to just set an environment variable on the Docker container to change any variable you use.
Okay. Just one question. Did you like choose specific languages for specific parts of your architecture?
No, because...
Or was it just to try out different languages?
No, because the setup was all done with Clojure, and well, for time it was also everything only in Clojure. So the only thing that I changed is the command handler. So the thing really checking, mostly there's an a command to transfer money. Is it valid? Because is the token valid? Can I subscribe the money? And then does this subscription and also generates a balance change account. Who knows about Rust before coming here? Who's written Rust? Yeah, it's kind of seen as a hard language, which isn't really my idea, but maybe because everybody says it's like very hard to learn, I was expecting it to be very hard. And I didn't find it that hard. Because there's like the Rust book, it's called, and it's really, I found it a very nice introduction to Rust. Rust has like, it's very memory safe, because it's like when memory goes out of scope, it's away, which also makes it a bit more difficult to make really concurrent things with it and reuse things. So for example, for the command handler application, there's a pool to make data connections to the database, because there are several, like two different processes that need to sometimes call the database, and was a bit of a hassle to set up properly. And also they're sharing the same producer, and because the producer is also like a mutable artifact, so the way it now works is I'm creating a channel and then putting in all the stuff that needs to be sent to Kafka. And then there's a single producer reading from a channel and reproducing the stuff to the Kafka. It's still sponsored by Mozilla. Dropbox is using Rust in production, and also parts of the Firefox browser are written in Rust. And it's one of the main things, of easiest things to go to WebAssembly, and also for WebAssembly there's like separate Rust WebAssembly book that makes it really easy to get into WebAssembly. That's also one of the nice things about it being a system language, is that it's like really low level. So there's like two libraries to work with Kafka. And one of them is purely written in Rust. And with that, it's possible to really just compile it to a static image. And then you can just put it into a container just from scratch. So just an empty container, put it in there, and then it works. And then you get a really small Docker size. Well, smaller you almost can't get. Some of the nice things of the database library there was that you can really do updates based on the current amount. So like with Clojure and also Kotlin, it is also possible, but a bit more difficult, because currently with the Kotlin and the Clojure one, it could happen that at some part there's adding money, and also there's money subscribed from it, and that it will cause an inconsistency. So it's also just a pet project, so it's nowhere near production ready. There's some code assembly for Rust, so there's a lot of the things with Rust work with matches. So you can either start something, then check whether it went fine or not, and really handle errors well. There's also a way to just put a question mark behind it, and then but then when it fails, then your whole application crashes. These are some of the results I run on Travis CI. I also ran them first on my laptop, but then it's very annoying to have something run on your laptop and then you can't use your laptop for some time. And this was quite easy to just use Travis CI for it and then just start some processes up and then copying the data later on. So as you can see the Rust image using just the native Rust library, then I can get it fairly easy down to just 8 megabytes. The Rust using the RA Kafka, that's using the Libre Kafka library, which recently got the 1.0.0 release. It's also the Omniment producer. And the Kotlin and the Clojure ones are a bit larger. The starting time is like when it automatically starts up and starts all the containers, and then it's using the browser to start up and to making its first and then log in. So then everything has to be started up, but since there are just two CPUs, it takes some time. So the Kotlin one is like almost 13 seconds and the other ones are a bit faster. Then there's the max load reach. So like I said, when they did almost always at the end, then 3 times in a row, it takes more than 5 seconds to make a transaction. And then the application, the test stops. And apparently Kotlin can go through for a bit longer using the streams API underneath. Clojure is very close to it. The problem with the Rust, the native Rust library, is that there's not a good way to send multiple messages, because it will not check if you send multiple messages at a time to it, if the message becomes too big. So now each time it's just sending one message, and that's causing a lot of load on the broker. So for each single message, you have to send back whether it received that single message or not. And that's causing it to fail pretty early. So this is the average latency. So that's from doing a transaction till seeing it on detecting it on the screen. And you can also really see the red line very quickly going up, because that's just that he can't keep by, because it's really like have to send something back for everything that's produced. This is like the load on the Kafka broker during the test. So both of the GVM languages, they are quite the same, which makes kind of sense since almost the same thing happens. You can really see the will Kafka really spike from all the single produced messages, most likely. And the RA Kafka one is also going way more up than the GVM ones. What I suspect that's happening here is that because it's an async library, that it's like keep polling the broker for additional messages while they aren't handled yet. So instead of just getting a bunch of messages, going through them, and then getting the next bunch of messages, it's at the same time getting messages, and also handling them all. So that could probably be improved. But that part of the library is really built to, with in mind with a lot of CPU and stuff, and then it makes sense to set it up like that to get a high performance. And this is the CPU of the the command handler application. So you see both GVM languages at the startup. It's really like the JIT going into place, and also the garbage collection triggering a lot of CPU. But you can also see that the pure Rust one is having a bit less, needs a bit less CPU than the other one. Apparently the Clojure one and the Rust one are eventually about the same. Any more questions about graph or?
I'm a bit missing the context. So how did you run this test? So you had clients, every client has its own host, one instance, right?
It's all on one instance. And in this case, it's all run on Travis on just two CPUs.
I understand the clients, but then you're pointing to a broker that is running.
Also there. So there's like one, well, actually three Docker files. And I just brought up on the same machine. And also the browser is running on the same machine.
So it's all in the local machine, in one machine with yeah. two CPUs, and you're running yeah. three Docker containers, one with the Docker.
Yeah. But it's open source, so you can run it on more machines, but I wasn't,
yeah.
well, not the time. But yeah. And it should also be quite easy to plug in something else, because also for running the test, it's really like go to this page, just click here, and wait till you see this value at that query. So I think even if you're like most likely not run on Clojure, but you do have a Docker image, you can use to load the application, and it has some front end, then you possibly could switch them out and also use it to do performance testing.
I'm also wondering, all these tests, you have all these dilemmas, you have a database as well, right?
Yes.
So is there any difference in how these languages interact with the database that could explain some of the performance?
Yes, some of them, because I don't have them in the slides, but they are like, they are online, and you can see with Rust libraries, the load on the database is about twice as high. And that's most likely because of the updating. But that's also pretty convenient, because if you really want to use one of the GVM ones, you have to work some other way around it. So either write SQL or something else. This is the memory, because it was, well, if you give Java a bunch of memory, then it just will take the memory. So it was a bit of tinkering to get it to work. I didn't try a lot of things, so it was like steps of 100 megabytes adding and then retracting. And so pretty much it's going stable, and then it's just processing stuff. And in the case of the GVM ones, it's garbage collecting probably all the time. And in the case of Rust, it's just when it goes outside of scope, then it's freed up again. So then to the conclusion, you could use Rust when the startup time is important, because the difference now wasn't that big, but that was because part of the application was still running on GVM parts. So I also eventually would like to use Rust for all the parts. But one of the things that's still missing is there is a GraphQL client in Rust, but it's missing subscriptions. So currently I can't write it all in Rust. And I think they're kind of moving towards it now. Also because finally in Rust, async is now getting to the stable Rust, because Rust is working with like three trains. And one of those three trains is a stable one, but it's kind of like finalized. So once it's like everybody thinks it's good and this is the right way to do it, then it can go to stable Rust, and especially with async and how to implement it, there were a lot of discussions and stuff like it. It seems like mostly it will get to stable very soon. When you would like a very small Docker image, you could also use Rust. So it's about as small as you can get. Not sure how it's with Go, because that's maybe also getting very small. And also have a very small footprint. It does take a bit longer to develop with Rust, but it's also kind of satisfying when finally it just compiles and it's fine. And then also most of the times it's also just it works when it compiles, so that's also nice. So it can take a bit longer, and you have to check if what the application does, if that's still possible with Rust. Like what I just mentioned, like subscriptions with GraphQL, it's not yet possible. So are there more questions? Or
so what exactly takes longer when you write code in Rust?
Well, you have to think about everything, especially when you do concurrent things. So in Java, you can just create an object, pass it to a thread, and then maybe when you get the thread back with a join handle, pass it to another thread, or have multiple threads use the same object. Mm-hmm. At Rust, it's not that easily, because you have to kind of, you have like a reference counter that you can put on objects. So there are some constructs around it, but you have to very much think about it. And also, when do you pass a reference to an object, and when do you pass the whole object? And sometimes you may need both, like you want to keep the object and also send the object, so then you have to copy it. Mm-hmm. So it's, you can kind of make it yourself very easy and just copy all the time, but that's not what you want. And it's also a nice way of thinking, being so close to the metal, like that you don't have that with Java, then it's just objects, and the garbage collector will move them out when it can, when it needs to.
You mentioned with the native Rust client that it has a problem around not being able to send multiple messages at once due to memory. Is that also true in the RDKafka based one as well?
So the question is, like, why does the Kafka native variant have these problems, and does the RDKafka one also have these problems? Well, no, because the RDKafka one is like wrapped around libkafka, and this has like the same as Java has the linger MS setting. So then you can say if you set the linger MS at 100 milliseconds. Once you start producing, it will wait till either queue fills up or the 100 milliseconds are passed, and then sending the whole bunch to the broker. But the pure Rust one doesn't have that setting. So you have like two methods to send, which is either just one message and then wait for it to get back, or send a bunch of messages. But if you send a bunch of messages, it might also be too many messages, and then you get an error back. So there's you could write something around it, like trying to figure out how big your messages are and then just sending that much of messages, but it's not in there.
Do you think they're likely to add it?
I'm thinking about it, but I'm having a bit, because I have like had some communication like on both of the open source Rust clients, but on the RDKafka one, there's like a pull request just to update the Docker images, and it's already open for 3 weeks. And also on the other one, that's even the pure Rust one is even worse. There's like almost no activity in 2 years, and the activity that is there is just from people using the library and having problems with it. So, yeah. No. Because there's also like when rebalancing or stuff like that, then it doesn't solve it itself. But if you run it in a Docker container and you just have the Docker container restart and it's fast restart, and it's not a critical process, then you could start that way to use it in production, but not for very crucial things.
Also a dictator behind Rust, or only?
No, it's very community driven.
Oh.
it's Mozilla, right?
Yeah. That's funding, yeah. And there was kind of from Grant Shapiro from Confluent is kind of hint to maybe rewrite things in Rust, but I don't think that was very serious, because apparently there are like 20 people with Confluent that are already also very into Rust, and they kind of searching for an excuse to use Rust for something. But not sure what will happen with it.
Right, final question.
I have one. Did you look at Scala, or is there a reason why Scala is not on your list?
There's not really a good reason it's not there. It's just, yeah.
All right. Thanks, Gerard.
Yep. Talk.